A brief story, just so you understand how Hollywood works. When I had written Ghost, I walked out of the commissary with a number of executives, and they turned to me as we were walking, and they said, "Bruce, we just want you to know that Ghost is the best script we have ever read." And I couldn't quite believe it, but I just felt, oh my God, this is extraordinary. I felt so wonderful. And I sort of floated away. About a week later, I was walking out of the commissary behind those same executives who were walking with another writer. And I was listening to them. And they said to the writer, "We just want you to know that your script is the best script we have ever read."
You know what I'm thinking? Why don't you and I, we sit down, we write the script over where it needs it.
You could write one of these.
There's nothing to it. All you do, you get an idea, you set down what you want to say on paper. Then you hire somebody else to fill in the commas and shit where they belong, if you're not positive yourself. Maybe fix up the spelling where you have some tricky words. Although, I've seen some scripts, I know the words weren't spelled right. There was hardly any commas in it at all. So I don't think that's too important. All right, you get to the end, you write in, fade out. You're done.
That's it.
That's it.
That's all there is to it. Then what the fuck do I need you for?
If you go to a store and buy a play by Tennessee Williams or someone, you can come home in your chair and open the play and read it and have a real experience with it. You haven't seen the play, but you've read it. Well, the same thing should be true of a good screenplay. You bring it home, sit in your chair, and you should have an experience with that because the writer has created a play.
The most difficult thing a screenwriter does, which is the most difficult thing in movie making, is to make a precise, detailed decision. It's easy to say, let's have an exciting chase along the beach here where he finds out that his partner is going to betray him. And the person who says that thinks, I'm a genius. I just came up with a scene. That's not hard. Anybody can do that after a while watching movies.
Screenwriting is kind of invisible. If screenwriting is done really, really well, it seems like the actors made up their lines and that the director knew to put the camera there and that the movie sort of came together all by itself.
There's so much to master, from character to dialogue to plot to theme to concept. And it's this machine with a lot of levers and buttons, and when you're starting out, it takes a long time to master all those things and play them, you know, like a pipe organ, well, all at the same time.
The screenplay is mathematical. It is like music, and it is precise. It's not like a novel. It's not like freeform poetry. It happens in time. It starts and it ends, and you write it over a long period of time, but you experience it in a finite period of time.
Movies are more or less 2 hours long, give or take. Well, that's like telling the painter how big your canvas is every time. But you can, in that 2 hours, you can tell a wonderful tiny little story, or you can tell a huge, gigantic epic.
When I write a screenplay, I always write an outline beforehand, because films are architecture. And you need to get your blueprint down, which is your outline, or else you're going to be completely lost.
Screenplays are structure and their story, and that's all they are. And the quality of writing, which is crucial in almost every other form of literature, it's not what makes a screenplay work.
You're like the architect, but they're building the building. And sometimes they decide, you know what, that's not quite the building we want. We're going to bring in somebody else to sort of design the new gazebo.
If you're a purist and you don't want your words touched, you should either be a playwright or an author. Because if you're going to be a screenplay writer and expect that your words are going to be treated like gold, that's just not reality.
The writer in Hollywood is truly, truly, you know, abused entity, and it can be said any number of times in ways, and it gets boring, and it's gone back to the beginning of Hollywood. It is really cruel on some levels that writers have so little participation in the work they create.
Part of the kind of surrealistic experience in Hollywood is that the originator of the material, from the moment everyone else claims to love it, is then the subject of an attempt to remove them from the material as much as possible.
When the Writers Guild started all that time back, the writers were the low man on the totem pole, and not only that, the producer's girlfriend had a better chance of getting a writing credit than any writer ever did.
I actually think that the writer isn't even at the bottom of the totem pole. They're at the part that they stick in the ground, and then there's the totem pole.
The crap that a screenwriter has to endure, sometimes in the early days, sometimes not. Sometimes you're treated well then, too. But that the potential for that crap never goes away.
A lot of guys get used and abused. A lot of guys come up with ideas, but they can't pull them off, so they're rewritten and they're dumped. It's a rough game. It's a real rough game.
I wrote a spec sci-fi script a couple years ago. I'm, you know, big sci-fi fan, and I wrote it, and I decided it was going to be the first of a trilogy, and I'd kind of worked out what the other two were going to be, and we went out with it as a spec, and I kept getting the most interesting responses from people. I kept getting, people would call up and say, well, we want to talk about it. And I'd say, okay, where does this come from? What, did you adapt this from a book? You know, it feels like you adapt it from a book, or is it from a comic book? And I said, well, no, I mean, I sat down and I wrote it, you know, and they said, but it's so detailed and it feels like it's such a world. I mean, and I said, yeah, motherfucker, I'm a writer. I mean, what do you think we do?
Well, where's your script?
Script? I don't have a...
You don't have a script?
No.
Roger! Sorry. Camille! Can you get fucking Roger? You know what? I'm sorry. I've got a 3:30 and...
Well, can you help me find a script?
This is Hollywood. Just go outside and ask anyone you see to give you a script. A gardener, a cripple, a child molester. They've all got them. You just gotta find one.
It's as if there's this wall, right, around this place you want to get to. And there are cracks in the wall. And you're feeling the cracks, right? You're trying to find the crack. And the moment you find your crack and you slip through, that crack seals up and nobody else can get through that crack.
I had written a novel called No Way to Treat a Lady, which was very short. So to make it longer, I made a lot of chapters. There were like 60 chapters in a 150-page book. Cliff Robertson got a hold of it, thought I had written a screen treatment, and he asked me to do a movie for him that I did, and then he fired me from it immediately and won the Oscar for it, so he was not dumb, but it was all by mistake.
I used to haunt the various movies that were shot in New York City, you know, whether it was North by Northwest, where I followed Hitchcock around from one location to another. And that's what I did every weekend. And I kind of learned by watching.
For my thesis film, which was supposed to be a 30, 35 minute film, I was scripting it and it just felt like a feature idea. So I just let it go to feature length and actually wound up writing my first feature script, which is a film called Steelyard Blues. I was fortunate enough to get made a year after I graduated from UCLA.
I was a protege of Pauline Kael, and I thought I would become a film critic. I had gone to UCLA, but I had gotten an MA in film studies, not an MFA in filmmaking. And then I hit a rough patch in my life, and I had to turn to fiction, to fantasy, to sort of exorcise these things that were eating me up. And out of that came Taxi Driver, and then I went on and wrote other scripts.
In television, you learn to tailor the part for the actor, so I just did the same thing with Nick Nolte and Eddie Murphy. I met them both, I talked to them a little bit, and I said, okay, I've heard them talk, now I can fit their speech pattern. And that was 48 Hours, which is my first screenplay. I was lucky to sort of hit my stride at a time when the kind of movies that I liked hit their stride, not just in America, but in the global marketplace.
I was hired by Ed Pressman, the producer, to be his story editor. It was in 1980. He optioned a script of mine and he didn't have any money to pay me, so he offered me a job. I had to read 20 scripts a week and report on them. And at night I was writing my own. And if you read 20 scripts a week, you really quickly learn what a good screenplay is.
they called me up and said, we'd like you to write for this new show called Amazing Stories. I was on food stamps at the time, and this was a tremendous opportunity. I wrote it in 3 days based on Stephen's story, and they asked me to do another one right away. So, you know, I went from food stamps and good wishes to working for Steven Spielberg.
I just wanted to make a movie about lesbians, and so me and my girlfriend decided we were gonna make a movie about lesbians, and we just wrote a script. And then it was far more widely successful than we had at all anticipated, and hence life went into screenwriting.
I produced a small feature in 97, a little $250,000 film, art house film, with Bryan Singer. Then at the end of that, I needed a job, and so Bryan was kind enough to give me a job answering the phones on his next production, which was X-Men. And the whole time he was complaining about the script and saying, oh, I hate this, and this isn't working, and this is gonna ruin my career. So one day I just said, look, why don't you have a scene where Wolverine and Cyclops run into each other on the mansion grounds, Wolverine says this and Cyclops says this, and then that'll tie up what you've already done and set you up for what you want to do down the road. And he said, good, yeah, go write that scene for me. He asked me to start coming to story meetings and take notes and not tell the studio what I was doing. The studio eventually found out, and then I ended up getting sole credit and the movie came out, and so I was extremely fortunate with my first writing job.
Having watched my father go through it, it was, I think I was actually better suited to deal with a lot of the challenges than many of the people who come out here. I can't envision Ghost as being separate from my childhood experience in regards to Ghost. And so it's hard to even envision what other people think of me in terms of Ari, the son of Bruce.
I used to be homeless when I was a teenager because I didn't have any family or any parents. I was a security guard on the Sony Pictures lot. I had found my family and I wanted to go and meet them, but I hadn't been at that job long enough to acquire any leave. So I had to tell my boss why I wanted to go. And once I told him a little bit of my story, and he said, go on. When I came back, Barry Josephson and a lot of other people were wanting to hear my story, and they said it would make for a good movie, and maybe, and I insisted on writing it.
The price of getting in to the film business, and probably a lot of other businesses that have a lot of competition, is figuring out your, you know, path. If there's a brick wall in front of you, are you going to ram your head against it? Are you going to build a ladder? Are you going to dig a tunnel? Are you going to sit back in a beach chair and watch everybody else hit their head against it until you know, how are you going to get over that wall?
I'd like to speak to an agent. An important one, powerful.
I need a name.
Well, I'll tell you, I got a better idea. You give me their names, and I'll send them all a copy of my script, and the one who gets me the best deal will be my agent.
Sir, our policy doesn't allow us to accept unsolicited material.
What do you mean you don't accept unsolicited material? If I could solicit my own material, I wouldn't need an agent, now would I?
I'm afraid I have other calls. Goodbye.
My God, the situations I wrote under when I was starting out with two little kids and having to get up with them, but then having to write at night when they were asleep, and it's just kind of a tricky situation. In fact, I remember one day that Kurt Voss and I were working on the script, and the kids were running around. I was like, you kids, go in the other room, we're working. And my oldest daughter put her arm around the little one. She goes, come on, Devin, let's go. They're working. They're always working, and they never get paid for it.
The long drought till you get to be a real screenwriter and make money. The years of not having any money and people going, so what else do you do? You know what I mean? So you're a writer, and what else do you do? How do you pay your bills? That's a reality.
Even if it takes you 10 years or 9 years like it took me to start working as a professional, develop and hone your skills. And don't think that the first thing you're going to write is going to sell for $1 million. Because I got news for you. It ain't.
you don't know what to expect. And I think that's probably best. Because if you knew what was going to come, you wouldn't do it.
In a way, you're just waiting for that right opportunity. Like, you know this is going to be the bullseye for the right person. And how many times have we heard that story? I sent it out a million times. Everybody rejected it. Great people rejected it. Smart people rejected it. And then one guy stumbles on it and says, this is exactly what I've been looking for.
I sold my first project when I was 20, and people were calling me a wunderkind. And then nothing happened for about 7 years. None of my films have played in a big theater in America, but most of my films have gone out on HBO, TNT, and then video and DVD. It's been a little bit frustrating. I wish that I had a bigger career, and there have been several almosts. Clint Eastwood was thinking about doing a project of mine, but did not. Michelle Pfeiffer almost said yes, but she chose something else. Someone along the line says no, and your career goes a different way.
If you want to write movies, you can't stop after you get pissed on and rejected, because you're going to get pissed on and rejected, because nobody wants your stuff. Once you basically become somebody, they'll read it. But nobody wants to basically give anybody their first shot.
If you don't know anybody, you definitely have to lie. I read the trades and found out who was opening new agencies, called them, claimed I knew friends of theirs. Sometimes I would know somebody who would give me a name, and eventually I ended up with the agent. She busted me. She said, you don't really know this person. I said, no. She goes, I'll read it anyhow.
I called this guy, Bruce Kaufman, and I said, I've just read this novel that I think you should see. And I tore the title page off, and I sent him the novel that I had written. And he called me back a couple weeks later and said, I like this very much. Who wrote this? I said, I did. Will you represent me? And he said, yes, and he's been my agent ever since. The joke is that I'm trying to make it through my career with one agent and one wife, and so far I've managed on both counts.
I remember talking one time to Freddie Fields, who was a big agent at one time out here. CMA was a big agency, and he was the head of it. And he says, I'd rather sell a bad script than a good script. Anybody can sell a good script. But for me to go out and get all that money for a piece of junk, that proves what a good agent I am.
I got my first job while I was still a film student. I got it my third semester of school. And it was a pretty big job, even though we got paid minimum. There was an established director, Ted Demme, and there was New Line Cinema was producing it. So it was firm, you know, and the whole thing was packaged by CAA. So my new writing partner and I sort of said, this is it. You know, CAA is gonna represent us, and they're huge, and it's gonna launch our career, and we're set. And I remember right after we got the job, CAA called us in for a meeting. So we put on our best suits and sat in the waiting room and looked at the atrium and were just overwhelmed by CAA. And the third assistant came down and introduced himself. And the second assistant brought us into the first assistant. And we finally got brought in to meet the agent. And it was probably a 3 or 4 minute meeting. We went in and he sat us down. He said, look, we don't know who the fuck you guys are. So we're not really gonna do anything for you. So, you know, all I can tell you is, you know, after you leave my office, you should go try to find another agent if you can. And then years from now, when we're begging to have you back, tell us to go fuck ourselves. Have a nice day.
I read your script.
And?
Well, let me put this in a form that isn't insulting, because I tend to be too direct. All my friends tell me that. The script's no good.
That's the form that's not insulting? What would the insulting form be?
Oh, good one.
What are you doing?
Oh, I write down lines I like. I like that line.
If I want to write, I sit down at the keyboard and write. If I want to draw, take a number 2 soft pencil and a blank piece of paper, and I draw. If I want to make a film, I'm asking somebody for money. And the only reason why they're going to give me money is they think they're going to make more money back than they gave me. If they didn't think they were going to make more money back than they gave me, they'd be idiots to give me the money.
Before this interview, I thought I would do a little homework. I put a column of original screenplays sold and produced, and I have 3 of those. Sold but not produced, I have 6 of those. And not sold or produced, I have 9. I was a little surprised. I thought, well, that's a lot of work, and that's a lot of pages that stayed on the shelf, and nine scripts, 120 pages each. That's a lot of pages that never saw the light of day here. I remember I should have had a signal about this one script called Rapture that they bought an option on at this production company. I walked in, and the first thing the executive said to me was, you know, we really like your script for what it can be.
Something that will always sell in Hollywood is high concept. And it's usually, you take this, and you match it with that, and then you got a movie. Like with my show, Innocent Blood, it was mafia, vampires, hey, it's a movie.
There's a phrase you hear in Hollywood, it's a movie. And I didn't really understand that phrase when I first came into the business. It's code for this script encompasses everything we need it to be. It can attract an actor, it can attract a director, it can be marketed, it can attract an audience, it's a movie, it's complete.
The first two movies I wrote got made. So I had this very sort of unrealistic idea about how this worked. It sort of seemed like, well, you write a movie, it gets made. And it wasn't until later I realized, you know, a lot of times you write a movie, it doesn't get made.
I had a project at Fox where I'd gone through all the steps, gone up the ladder, and my agent said, well, they really want to do a deal, but the vice president of production has to hear the pitch. I waited for an hour and a half for this guy to be ready, and I go into his office, and he's on his couch moaning in pain. He had thrown his back out and was going to go see his chiropractor in an hour to get it fixed. And I said, listen, you know, it doesn't seem like the best time to pitch to you. Maybe I should come back when you're feeling a little bit better. And he goes, nah, let's just get it over with. So I didn't sell that project.
Sitting here with all of you people looking at me and saying, this is what it would look like, to me is crazy because a script is already a description of a thing. It's a description of a TV show or of a movie. And so to be describing the description of the thing is just, it's just existential madness.
You go in and pitch something, and you do a very good pitch, and the person you pitch to goes down the hall and does a completely inadequate pitch trying to paraphrase all the things you've said, and they usually can't do it very well. So what's getting turned down is not what you pitched, it's what they pitched.
For 5 years, I went into offices and I made the pitch, and I got very, very good at pitching Akeel and the Bee. And we were never, ever, ever turned down because of the quality of the project. There was no mandate at any of these companies to make a movie about a little girl from the inner city who competes to get into the National Spelling Bee. It was so different from what they'd made. There is a hesitancy to do anything risky or new by folks who are trying to keep their jobs.
I think, yeah, one of the weirdest rejections I ever had was for War of the Worlds. Steven Spielberg had come to me and he wanted me to adapt the book, and he said, you know, think about it, come back, and we'll talk about it. I called him up and to pitch him the idea. I remember he was like on Martha's Vineyard, you know, taking his son to a guitar store or something, and I'm trying to pitch him all these parallel parking, and I give him this whole big, kind of like my great original take on it. And at the end of my 20 minutes monologue, he said, no. I said, all right. And he said, yeah, I don't want to do that. I was devastated. I was like, oh, there was my chance, and it's done. And I said, well, good luck. He goes, what do you mean? Don't you want to do the movie? I said, well, yeah, but you hate my idea. That's all I got. And he said, well, I like this one tiny little part over here in the corner. Why don't we start with that and let's go do it? And I said, all right. And I got off the phone. I called my agent. I said, well, I think I just got the job, but I'm terrified because I don't have an idea.
I've never gone in and verbally pitched something. I can't do it. I don't know how to do it. It's always on paper first. Or a producer or studio head will say, we'd like to do X. And I'd say, well, I think I can do that. But in the broadest general terms, I would never come in and be able to tell a story just because I'm not that much of an actor.
Inevitably, everybody says it's wonderful, and they walk into the elevator and their arms around your shoulder and they thank you for coming in and they're all smiles, and the elevator door closes and you go home and the agent calls an hour later and says they passed.
There are soft passes and hard passes and cold passes and helpful passes and encouraging passes.
They're saying, okay, if I trust this guy with $80,000 or, you know, $800,000. It doesn't matter where you are in your career. Is that an investment that's going to pay off?
They're not in trouble if they say no. Nothing bad can happen to them, and they won't lose any money. The moment they say yes, their troubles begin. If you're an agent, you now have a new client for whom you have to get work. If you're a studio executive, you have to sell this idea to all of your compatriots. If you're a producer, you have to go get some studio interested in actually making this movie. If you say no, you can just go to lunch.
I was thinking about Saving Private Ryan, actually. This is a tangent, but it's not. I mean, the opening scene where all those people getting mowed down by machine guns trying to get on the beach. And I think that's just the way it is in screenwriting, you know? I mean, one of my professor friends told me that they pick young people to go to war. One reason is because they don't think they're going to die. And I think that young screenwriters, it's the same thing. You just think you're going to succeed and you're not going to fail. Then after a while, just realize that's all there is out there. And you're lucky to just be standing after the initial wave, you know, of machine gun bullets.
Seriously, Bart, I like you. We're off to a good start. If all my writers were like you, I wouldn't have to get so goddamn involved. I'd like to see something by the end of the week. Oh, heard about your show, by the way. My man in New York saw it. Tells me it's pretty damn powerful, pretty damn moving. A little fruity, he said. But I guess you know what you're doing. Thanks for your heart, Bob. We need more heart in motion pictures. We're all expecting great things.
Most of us have been pushing very hard against a wall. And we've been pushing and pushing for so long that when it suddenly disappears, we're falling in free fall into space. And that is a fair definition of success.
When I wrote Alien, co-wrote with Dan, my rent was $200 a month. I was living in Hollywood, and my wife was paying that. She was supporting Dan and I, who was living on our living room couch. So when we got a $15,000 option money for writing it on spec, we said that was a lot of money.
By the time I had gotten to college, I had written a couple of full-length plays. And as soon as I graduated, I wrote two or three scripts to the writing partner, and the second or third was Last Action Hero. I sold that script right out of college, and that got made into the infamous bomb that it was. Being part of that kind of spec auction where your agent is calling and you have no money and you're saying they just bid 100,000, they just bid 200,000, where you're, you know, it's like winning the lottery for something that you actually did, you know, as opposed to for luck.
Once I sold Yakuza, and it was sold for the highest fee going at that time, it got involved in an auction. The first day there were 16 bids. And so that immediately gave me a profile. And I decided I better write as fast and as hard as I can now. And so I just started writing like crazy. Wrote Obsession, wrote Rolling Thunder, wrote Hardcore, just started trying to knock these things out as quickly as I could.
I learned early on that I can't write anything if it's not about me. Well, I don't mean that in the sense of megalomania, but about my experiences, about my needs, fears, desires, whatever. So that even if it's about a photographer in the Nicaraguan Revolution, his issues have to be issues that I care about personally. I would make a lot more money if I was a good mercenary. If I could, you know, if somebody says, here, we'll pay you $3 million to ride a ship about aliens and space stars exploding, I can't do it. I want your money, but I don't know how. It's not my experience.
That big paycheck, on two occasions, bigger than anybody's received for screenwriting in history, was a curse that ended up sort of taking me out for a few years and not really letting me enjoy A, my work, or B, continue to produce at the level of frequency that I was before. I just was scared, petrified. And it can freeze you.
It's hard to find a Shawshank every time you make a movie. If it were easy, everybody would be making Shawshank, you know. Your first movie gets nominated for Best Picture and Best Screenplay, and it can be daunting, it can be somewhat crippling, if you let it. And, you know, the idea is to not let it be those things, because, you know, it's like, well, how are you going to top that? Maybe you shouldn't even try.
I decided to keep the smoke in my ass and not let it get to my head. Because of the fact that there's a lot of smoke that comes at you, especially after the success of Ray and things like that. There's a lot of smoke that comes at you. And if you start believing the hype, then you can't be creative.
The word hubris, the Greek word, the root of that means you stop listening. And I think that's the biggest danger you can get into. And you think you've got all the answers or you've got all the experience in the world.
When I was offered The Karate Kid, I said I'd be willing to do it if he lost the fight at the end. You can't have Mr. Miyagi tell him that it doesn't matter whether you win or lose for 90 minutes and then have to have him win. But that's because I was being a moron. I was being sort of an inflated sense of that young Turk who thinks he's going to be in the business for 90 years and he can flout convention. Now, they made four sequels to that movie, so obviously I was wrong.
We wrote a movie called Magooch.
Oh, yeah, let's talk about
which,
that.
Who knows, maybe we may see one day, but that was a great rejection we often laugh about. In the sense, not it actually led to lots of great meetings and stuff, but yeah. we have Bruce Almighty, it makes almost $1 billion worldwide. We're like, man, you know, you start to believe your own, you know, crap, you know, pardon.
Yeah.
like maybe we got something here. We wrote this script and we loved it. It was a black comedy and just very dark, and but we loved it, and we said this is gonna go just like Bruce Almighty went, you know, it's gonna hit the market, someone's gonna buy it, a big spec sale. In fact we went out the night before. We went out the night before to a diner. Just like to sort of like celebrate that we were going out with this, like how lucky America was to be getting this movie we had written.
I know, we were counting our money.
And we had, in fact, someone took a picture of us the night before we were going out.
We wrote like the night before the Magooch spec sale. The night before the big sale.
And then guess what? No one was interested.
Nobody gives you credit for the previous time at bat. You say, oh, you were so great yesterday, and we're going to let you go to first base without even having to go to the plate. No, you have to get a hit every time you're up.
I don't know how much my movie made, but I think it made $14 million. And I don't think I'm going to get that movie made again. You know, when we went in, we were stoked. We were like, look, you haven't seen this in a while. You haven't seen this since Stella Got Her Groove Back, about a professional woman looking for love, and it's been a while. Let's do it. And she's upscale and this, that, and the other. Not big box office. That's the honest to God truth, you know? So, you know, and I think studios were like, they're not like, oh, let's get another something new going on.
In spite of Alien, it took me 8 years to get Total Recall made. Nobody wanted to make it. I couldn't get a big enough package, either one or the other. Maybe I had a director, then I couldn't get an actor. I had an actor, I couldn't get a director. It was big enough. And this went on for 8 years.
I think in the film business, there is never one breakthrough moment. It's always a series of moments. Coming out of USC, I won the Nickel Fellowship for my thesis script, and that got me a lot of attention. And from there, I got hired on to do a couple of jobs here and there. And then my first real big break, I think, was when we got Air Force One off the ground, when the script went to Harrison Ford, and he said yes.
At a certain point, once you've made enough in box office, then that's your reputation. You have a reputation as a moneymaker, and that's the best reputation of all to have, frankly, if you want to continue to work.
Coppola told me after he made The Godfather, he said, I can fail for 10 years now. Well, he was wrong. He can fail for 30 years. You know, once you make a big hit, you know, life becomes easy.
I got to a point where I was actually getting kind of disgusted with myself, because I wasn't writing much, I wasn't writing well, and had just sort of fallen into this laconic malaise. And one day, I woke up and I was lying in bed thinking, all right, I gotta get my shit together. And I got a piece of paper and I wrote at the top, Justin's list of things to do before he kicks the bucket. Number one, get a film made at a major studio. Find the perfect woman, convince her that I'm not a schmuck, get her to marry me. I wrote the whole story of the bucket list. And ultimately, the story is these guys each have their own list of things that they want to do with the short time they have left, but the one thing that's not on either of their lists that they're both missing is a true friend. All the studio said no. One of them said, well, I really think if you get this in the right hands, this could get done. They said, so given any director in the world you'd want to shoot this, who would it be? I was like, Rob Reiner's made some pretty good movies. 3 days later, he called up, hello, I've read 13 pages of this thing, and if it's okay with you, this would be my next movie. I had written the movie with Morgan Freeman's voice in my head. Rob got Morgan's number and called him up and said, hey, I've got this script you should read. And a week later, Morgan said yes. We'd been talking about who would play the other character, and Rob and I weren't sure, and we had a list of the usual suspects and a bunch of names, but we're never really sure who it would be. And Morgan said, Jack Nicholson and I have talked about always wanting to work together. And if I had a bucket list, working with Jack Nicholson would be on that list. And what are you gonna say to that? So sent the script to Jack, and a week later he called, yeah, I'll do it. And I'm sure the look on my face describes like what that was like. It was absolutely just, I think separated myself from any notion of reality at that point, and I still haven't come down. The greatest 24 hours of my life was September 3rd, 2006. I got married in New York. And the next morning I woke up at 5, kissed her goodbye, got on a plane, flew to Los Angeles, and drove up to Jack's house. And walked in, and I sat down at his dining room table, and it was me, Morgan Freeman, Rob Reiner, and Jack Nicholson. Who's the asshole at that table? And Rob started to read the stage direction, and the minute the first scene where the two actors talk to each other, it's just goosebumps. It was absolutely the most indescribable feeling, and it was perfect. Crazily enough, it was a year to the day that I went out with the script that we started principal photography. And that just doesn't happen.
You know, Universal is begging me for this script, but I don't want to give it to them because they screwed me once. You really ought to take a look at it.
Let me see.
Yeah, take a look at it. Yeah.
It starts nice.
It does, doesn't it?
What's happening? All this, yeah.
Right.
Gotcha, suckers. Wow, that is a catchphrase.
Isn't that good?
I just saw the poster.
Back when I was working my way in, it was more of a one-man show. And if somebody wanted your idea or your screenplay, but they wanted you to rewrite it, they couldn't screw around with it until you had turned in your version, and then they could do it. But nowadays, it's a whole different story, weirder.
The film studios used to be run by people who were in the film business, who had been producers, had been agents, who knew the game and the ups and downs of the game. But that all changed in the early 80s when Diller came from ABC over to Paramount, and he brought in Frank Mancuso and the whole concept of market research, because the studio executives hated the idea that they had to take the word of artists about what was going to make money.
We sort of moved into a post-content era now, if you're talking about a studio tentpole franchise project. And if you're interested in story and human emotion, I would not recommend chasing those kind of movies.
I'm not turned on by movies that are just sort of glorified comic books. I find that really boring and a bit of a cheat. The movies that made me become a writer are Ordinary People, Kramer versus Kramer, Tootsie, The World According to Garp, Network, Rocky, all the great stuff from the 70s. Fiddler on the Roof, Jaws, The Godfather, of course, the greatest movie ever, All the President's Men. Those movies are almost impossible to make now. And yet, those are the movies that I gravitate towards.
Ordinary People wouldn't get made anymore. It would be a lifetime television movie. You know, it's not the kind of thing that studios are doing. And those are the kinds of things I started my career doing. And those are the kinds of things that I think people are still hungry for.
We've got, you know, Pirates of the Caribbean, you know, 8 probably on the way. But and I understand it. Spider-Man, you know, 14, I get it, you know. They're gonna keep coming.
I go to meetings and they're talking about the sequel. I go to meetings where they say, we love the power of this scene where your leading lady says, they killed my best friend, they betrayed me. They'll pay, and they go, listen, you know, we really think this best friend is a really appealing character, and the actor we're thinking of getting is looking for a franchise. Do we have to kill that person? Could that person just be injured? And well, you know, that's sort of like a different thing. You know, when Scarlett O'Hara says, I swear to God I'll never be hungry again, you don't say, well, could she say, I swear to God, I'll never miss lunch?
Right now, I think it's the strangest it's ever been because the costs are so terrifying. And I remember when I started with Butch Cassidy, we had George Roy Hill, bless him, was a powerful director, and Paul Newman was the biggest star in the world, and I think the movie cost $4.8 million. If you were going to make Butch Cassidy today with Will Smith, let's say, and a named director, you're talking $150 million. And that's if you're lucky. And that kind of, that's what is one of the biggest changes, one of the things screenwriters have to deal with, is everything is so fucking expensive. And it's only going to get more so.
It's hard to explain what's going on now. The waters are turbulent, the waters are rising, and you just really got to be in the right place at the right time, and your idea has to be powerful enough that carries you along.
You know, the business changes. The goalposts move all the time. You can complain about it, you can try to kick it through the moving goalpost, and that's what I do.
I've had two movies made to date, The Grudge 1 in 2004, The Grudge 2 in 2006. I have a movie called Red, which is being shot right now, actually. That's three scripts. I've written 38 screenplays. The Grudge was my first film. It was my 25th screenplay.
Someone told me that Warner Brothers has 360 movies in development. Just let that number rattle around in your head. I mean, they're going to make 10 a year, 12 a year. So where are all those scripts going? They're going nowhere.
People love dogs. Lassie pictures always gross high.
So instead of a disease, we give the kid a dog?
Forget the kid. There is no kid. The kid's a dog.
Brilliant. Could be just what the movie needs.
Let's ask the writer. What do you think, Pete?
Wow, that's just amazing.
A movie that costs $70, $80, $100 million just to make is going to cost another $100 million just to promote. That's a $200 million risk. So of course, everybody's nervous. Everybody's going to second guess everything.
It's sometimes a miracle that a movie even comes out, given all the different points of view that are sometimes focused on it.
I think the public would be shocked to see how many movies that end up horrific started out as pretty good screenplays, or at least screenplays that you'd say, oh, I see why the studio made this movie. It's kind of funny, it's kind of silly. Oh, it's stupid, but it's, you know, charming. Oh, the action's really cool. It's just in the process of what they do to screenplays, it gets, you know, chopped and mashed and turned out.
There are very few development executives or producers who could actually sit down and write a screenplay and tell a story.
They don't really mean to be jerks. They don't mean to be obstinate. They don't mean to be stupid. They're just trying to get at something, and they can't usually articulate what it is they want.
I remember one moment that Kurt Voss and I were in a meeting with people that basically told us to do two things in the script that were diametrically opposed. I mean, almost everybody's had this experience. And Kurt says, okay, we can give you that, but I just want you to know you just asked for two entirely opposite things. You realize that? No, it's not opposite. Yeah, no, it's really opposite. You said she's supposed to be here, but she's also supposed to be, you know, you realize they're totally like in the real world, this, you know, in the world of living things, this can't actually be.
Your job being at the receiving end of a good idea in a development meeting is to handle this turd as if it was a piece of gold.
At breakfast that day, they're like, yeah, I can't wait. I'm going to go in there and make my comment that I have, you know. And that's their whole day, is waiting for that comment to come around so they can say that thing that their boss will hear. And that comment, which to you means nothing. It's like, are you insane? Shut up. You know, that to them, that was their day, was the comment. That's their job for that day, was to say that.
There's things, dynamics you don't know about, okay? There's this executive that's in your meeting, and she's been frustrated that every movie that comes out of this process turns into some kind of movie aimed at teenage boys with, you know, fart jokes, and she's trying to elevate the material. And then you have her arch enemy, who's not going to make any wussy movies. Then you have the person who's, like, job is shaky, who wants to show off in the meeting, right? So all this stuff is going on. So you want them to have a good meeting, right? That's the whole thing there. So one of the things you could do is you could go in there and leave opportunities for plug and play. See, if they can say anything in the meeting that they can think is their idea, then they're invested. So for example, you might say, and I think these villains are doing something. They're doing something to like screw with our economy. They want to mess with our money. They're trying to fool people. They're trying to tick people. They got a big suitcase full of counterfeit money. Yes, yes, that's right. It could be counterfeit money. Can I write that down?
Used to be two people would come into a meeting and work on a script with you. Now eight people come into a meeting and they've all got yellow pads and they've all got their opinions and most of the opinions are bad. And they can't judge anything that's original or different. They can only relate to something that they've seen before. If it hasn't been in some other movie and it's not familiar to them, then it's got to be wrong.
Have you ever heard about a study that somebody was doing about the perfect painting, judged on, you know, questions that were asked of potential painting lovers across the world? You know, that would have a landscape in it, it would have an animal somewhere in the front, it would have a pretty girl, and it would just have all these disparate elements, and then some artist came together based on the survey and did that painting, which of course was utterly horrible, hilarious painting. And that's kind of the way Hollywood generally works though. As you know, you'll get a focus group and they'll say, oh no, he needs a dog. Oh, what about the love story? I said, well, it's a war movie. It's gotta have a love story. So things do get cobbled together and you have these hideous Swiss Army knife beasts.
You can finalize and fine-tune a script down to the nth degree, and it's uninspiring. It doesn't move. It's too constructed. And sometimes you just need to break all that, and you need to, you know, mess it up a little bit and try to reinfuse some of that chaotic energy into it.
I don't go into an operating room and tell a surgeon, you know, use the wrong clamp, or, you know, I think you should cut, you know, a little more to the left. But any jackwad on a street corner will tell you what they felt was wrong with Spider-Man 3, you know. They have an opinion. And if they went to Yale or Brown, they could be at a studio and they could have that job. And the job is half of it having lunches and the other half is going in a meeting and getting paid to say, well, Spider-Man 3 was bad because of this.
Sometimes you get a note that says, well, this scene is boring, can we put in a car chase? What you should take from that note, that this scene, this quiet emotional scene that you intended to be emotionally devastating, is boring. And that means that you might not have done your work setting up the characters or the relationships 20, 30, 40 pages earlier.
You can completely disagree on two points within the framework of one grander vision of a movie. You know, if one person sees it as a comedy, one person sees it as a drama, that's a little different than, okay, we're making a comedy. We're going to make it the funniest comedy ever made. But I think this is funnier. No, I think this is funnier. You know, that's the creative process.
I did a film for Disney, and it was an idea they had, and there was a one-word idea. And they said, shadows. And I said, shadows, okay, what about shadows? They said, that's it, that's the idea, shadows, do something with it. So I came up with this idea about a guy whose shadow is alive. The guy is really awkward with women. And he likes this girl that he works with. His shadow and her shadow fall in love, and they contrive to get the human beings together. You know, I was happy with it, and I wrote the script. And Disney said, wow, it's really good, but, you know, it's a love story, and what we really want is a buddy film. Like, imagine your shadow is Eddie Murphy. And I said, well, that's interesting. It's completely not what I wrote. And it's like, you know, I'm used to getting notes where someone says, you know, okay, act two needs some work, but I'm not used to getting notes where they say, okay, let's change the genre.
I used to try to make everyone happy. And so if someone said that they didn't like something and had a suggestion, I would immediately try to incorporate that suggestion, which is one of the worst things you can possibly do.
They're not hiring you because they want to tell you what to do as a screenwriter. They're usually hiring you because they need advice, you know. So even if someone is sitting there saying, I don't want to hear your opinion, they do want to hear your opinion, that's why you're there. So you sometimes have to fight through that natural inclination that some people have to just kind of go with the flow. You know, the flow will push you right out the door.
When I was a young man out of the business and a young man in the business, I believed that my opinion was absolutely right and that I had the right answer to all questions. With age and experience, I learned that I was right on all of those occasions, but that there are several right answers to all occasions.
that scene?
The English writer, Monroe, Boxley. It's the last thing he wrote before he left.
What a great going-away present. Whoever heard anyone say, nor are you? Has anyone ever said, nor are you, to you? Nor are you. Nor are you. We'll have to rewrite the scene and reshoot it. It's absolute crap. People don't speak like that. Do I have any writers around here who understand the way people talk? Norman.
Yes, Monroe.
Put four writers on that scene tonight, and I want to see the rewrites before they shoot it.
The most important thing in screenwriters' arsenal is this. Wear flats. You never want to be taller than the producers, and whoever, and you are already. I'm just telling you right now, I don't have to do the statistics. I don't need a double-blind study. All the screenwriters are taller in general than all the producers.
Always sit on the couch. That's my advice to want to be writers when they get in there. Don't take that big chair. Let the producer or the director take that.
Everything in this business, in my mind, is based on relationships, and you build those relationships by being the mensch in the room and doing the work and coming up with great ideas. And sometimes it doesn't click for whatever reason, but it's those relationships you build with the producers at the base level. You know, they're going to know that you're the go-to guy for their next project.
Very often it's the guy that someone likes working with or knows or is handy or who happens to be on the phone Rolodex that day that gets the call. Relationships are very important. Is that a bad thing? If you're not in the circle, it can be extremely frustrating.
You have to know how to read the people you're with. It's like a dance. You have to know who your partner is. And you have so many dance partners. It's just like a night on the town. And you're going to this ballroom and you're going to dance with all these people. And you want to dance with them. But when it's time to switch partners, you can't get nostalgic.
I had lunch with a president of Disney after I had been working on Deep Impact. I had no idea he was planning Armageddon. And he was taking notes on everything I was saying. That was really clever. I thought that he was figuring out how to do a movie in juxtaposition to the movie that I was in the process of writing. He was getting all of my ideas. I wasn't really literally giving him my script, but I was talking to him enough about it that he could pick up the genre, the tone, the way I was working, the character-driven aspect of it. And it was really fascinating that there was a kind of subterfuge that was happening with this head of a major studio.
I called Joel Silver up on the phone and said, what'd you think of the script? He hemmed and hawed. So I said, Joel, did you read the script? And he said, well, I was exposed to it. I said, you were exposed to it. Does that mean they held it up and showed you the script and said, look, here's the script that Larry Cohen wrote for $500,000?
Joel has been an angel to me because through thick and thin, for whatever reason, his vision of what he wants to see in movies coincided enough with mine that he trusted me to get what he was saying. Kiss Kiss Bang Bang, Joel sort of ran interference for me because it's not that I wasn't trusted at that point by the studio, but I wasn't trusted. I was an unapproved element. I hadn't directed anything. Joel had made the Matrix films, the good first one and then the not so good next ones, but they all made $1 billion. So the studio says $15 million, give it to Joel. What are we going to do then? Sit on him? Yell at him? No, we're going to let him do what he wants with $15 million. He's earned that privilege.
I had one producer with his own source of funding offer me like a $30 million budget, conditional upon my changing that ending. He said, I will write you a check for $30 million bucks. You go make your movie before you leave the office. He literally had his pen poised. And I said, what ending would you like me to have? What is your suggestion for that? He said, I don't know. I said, I don't know either. This is the ending I've been thinking about for, 20 years now. If you have an alternative to suggest, by all means, suggest away. I may love it, I may hate it, I may laugh in your face, but I'll certainly listen to it. He didn't have that. So I said, thank you very much. I shook his hand and I walked out of the office without the $30 million check in my hand, and I went off and made the movie with Bob Weinstein instead.
Dino said to me, I want to make a sequel. I want to make a King Kong. But everybody say no, because King Kong is dead. You can't bring him back after he falls off the Empire State Building. I said, I have it. I said, you give him an artificial heart. And that's, it's huge. It'll be a funny scene. It'll be big as a Volkswagen lowered into his chest. After he's resuscitated, he meets
the love of his life. It's a giant female version of Kong. And he thinks for a minute, he says, "One thing bothers me, Ron. I don't think they accept a female ape this tall. Maybe another male, but it's too hard to accept." I thought for a moment and I said, "Dino, King Kong had to have a mother." "My God, you're right. We go with this."
I remember years ago I needed some money and I was good friends with Simpson and Bruckheimer. They were on a roll and they were paying writers a lot of money. We all had the same agent, Jeff Berg. And I went to Jeff and I said, "You know, Don and Jerry are paying out a lot of money to writers and I'm old friends with them. Why can't I get some of this money?" And he said, "Oh, why don't you have lunch?" So I had lunch with him on the Paramount lot and we all talked about doing something. And then a month went by and nothing came up. And I asked Jeff again, "You know, did you ever talk to Simpson?" And Jeff said, "Well, there's kind of a problem." I said, "What's that?" And he said, "Well, Don likes to beat up on writers, and he's not really comfortable beating up on you."
Let me approach this from a different way, because you're all, there's obviously something that isn't gelling about what we just did, all right?
I gotta be blind.
I understand. Okay, time. Look, this is just it's just paper. It's paper, and they put a letter and a name and a word, and then they called it a script. But you know what? Let's toss this away. Let's start from scratch.
Oh, Jesus. Okay.
I am a writer by choice, a producer through necessity, and a director in self-defense. And I learned that was a way to get your ideas on the screen, was to be able to control all of those areas.
As parasitic as it may feel to have a director come in and change your words or anything like that, that's the director's job. And that's what you've signed up for. You're providing a document, and that then is going to be turned into a film. And that is an entirely new evolution of the same story.
A movie set is like, it's like the military. And as a writer, you really have no place in the chain of command. So when you show up, you know, you're sort of this like weird creature and no one's like, what are you exactly? Where do you fit in?
There's really nothing for you to do. Your job's done. Unless, of course, in comedy, sometimes there's punch up on the set. But generally, it's like the director wants to do it the scene the way he's planned it out and the actors memorize the lines and, you know, you're just kind of there eating the egg salad.
There's a scene in Princess Bride where the hero is taking the heroine in the fire swamp and there's smoke and there's fire and her dress is on fire. And the hero, Wesley, puts it out and Buttercup's okay and they continue on. And now I wrote the book, I wrote the movie, and I'm watching this thing start. Wonderful Cary Elwes brings wonderful Robin Wright. There's the puff of smoke, her dress is on fire, and I scream, her dress is on fire, totally destroying the shot. And Rob turned and said, "Bill, it's supposed to be on fire."
It was very clear when I worked with Sidney Lumet that I was to talk to him and not to the actors. And the actors would call me only when they had his permission. That's part of the protocol, because there has to be a single leader.
Even when they don't have the final cut, they have final cut from you. So, you know, you can try to convince somebody of some great idea you have for a scene that they're not sure about. At the end of the day, if you may win the battle, but you aren't winning the war, and you will only learn that when you see the dailies.
When we were doing Jacob's Ladder, Adrian Lyne and I fought continually over the script. His visions were fascinating to me, but they were not my visions. But I had to learn to listen to his visions and to be able to accept them. And we started to have these very strong, very respectful dialogues about how the film should go. And he would listen to mine, and I would listen to him. And in the end, it's kind of an amalgamation of two different approaches. And in some sense, I think benefited from these extraordinary sort of involvements that we had in making the script he wanted to direct.
The original ending for the script that I sold, Innocent Blood, was I thought, a poignant and touching ending in which ultimately a father comes to terms with his child. Instead, it ended up with a flaming head rolling down a street outside of a stripper bar. The director had a concept. He had a thought. He wanted a big finish. And I didn't want to be finished with the movie, so I decided to do the best I could to make it my own. Once a movie is up and going and they're shooting it and there are hundreds of people involved, it is a moving train. And it's not going to slow down for the writer.
Scripts are late. Writers are 2 years late. I was 2 weeks late. Uwe Boll calls me, "This is fucking disgusting. You lied to me. Where is my script?" I was like, whoa. I just called my manager and I was like, that man is never allowed to call me again. And he never did. But I delivered the script probably a week after that. And he's like, "We love it. We go into production tomorrow." I was like, oh my God. Like, it was a first draft. It was a, you know, nasty little, scrappy little draft of a script that I was like, you know, hoping that, you know, the process begins. You say what you think, we blah, 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 it becomes something beautiful. No, into production. And I just want to say for the record, for the, anyone who's seen Blood Rain, that I would say that about 20% of what I wrote is on the screen. The producer called me when the movie was just being finished and he said, "Don't be alarmed, Gwen. Uwe changed a lot of the script." Uwe doesn't really speak English. And then he let the actors take a crack at it. But I was just like, letting go. I'm gonna let go. And I have to say that the only person at the premiere at Man's Chinese Theater who was laughing out loud was me. I was laughing out loud like, oh my God. It's like a $25 million movie and it blows. I mean, it's like the worst movie ever made. It's like, is it Showgirls worthy in terms of like how it's so bad that it's campy? I think it is. I think it's gonna ripen.
I'm sure glad I didn't make Taxi Driver. I wasn't the right person to make it back then. I didn't know how. Maybe I'm not even the right person now. The reason Mari and I clicked was that in essence, we were sort of the same guy. We were sort of these short, asthmatic film buffs with a lot of guilt and anger. Only he was Italian and urban and Catholic, and I was Dutch, rural, and Calvinist. We each had different elements, so that when we connected, he took my elements and exploded with them.
I've been lucky to make three movies now with Tim Burton, and everyone assumes that I must have this amazing relationship with Tim, and that, like, you know, we talk all the time and, you know, we're close buds. Literally, I've probably spent a total of 24 hours in Tim's presence over the course of three movies. The way Tim works is he'll send me something and say, like, "I want to do this." And I'll say, "Okay." And I'll figure out sort of what I think it is he kind of wants out of it. I'll have iced tea with him, like at his hotel, usually out in Santa Monica. I'll talk through sort of what I think I want to do with it, what I think needs to happen. He's like, "Yeah, go do that." And I'll go and do that. And that sort of becomes the movie.
Steven's like your kindly, you know, funny Jewish uncle who you're happy to have lunch with, and then he gives you kind of a couple little suggestions for your script, and you're thinking, "Oh, silly Jewish uncle, that's not, that can't work." And then you go home and you start working on the screenplay, and you're like, "Oh, that's kind of genius, isn't it?" You know, and I had that happen a number of times where, you know, he would say, "Well, why don't you try this or do this?" And I'd think, you know, I wouldn't think, "Oh, that was the most revelatory, genius, kind of Zen koan screenwriter moment I've had." And then you go and you kind of start implementing it, and it's in it, and all of a sudden a scene or a sequence or something just opens up in a way that you're like, "Wow, I guess he does know what he's doing. I guess he really is Steven Spielberg. He's not just my Uncle Steve." And you know, I mean, ultimately I got fired off of that. You know, I mean, Uncle Steve still can my ass.
The book 2010 was about this remarkable space voyage, except it had nothing to do with politics. I didn't want to make it about Russians and Americans getting along. I wanted to make it about Russians and Americans not getting along. And I said I would only do it if I had the approval of Arthur Clarke and Stanley Kubrick. I talked to Arthur Clarke. He said, "Absolutely, fabulous, do that." And I had these long series of talks with Stanley Kubrick, who couldn't have been sweeter, couldn't have been more supportive. First time we spoke, they had scheduled this phone call, and a call came through, and I was at my desk, and I stood up. I was standing on the phone, standing up, talking to him on the phone, and we talked for about 2.5 hours. At the end of it, he was just saying, "Don't be scared, don't be intimidated, just go make your movie." And hung up the phone and my assistant came running in and he said, well, what was it like? I said, well, we talked for 2.5 hours. I told him everything and he told me nothing. And about 6 months later, I was sitting with Arthur Clark and I said, Arthur, tell me about the first time you met Stanley. He said, well, we sat in a park bench in England and we talked for about 2.5 hours and I told him everything and he told me nothing.
You have to be able to watch a director do the horrible thing that happens to a script, which is unravel it, take it apart into pieces, and then try to put it back together again. And sometimes they put it back with one sleeve missing, you know, but then it has to be their turn. And if possible, you need to keep a respectful dialogue going with those people, because it's like handing your baby over and you have to, you know, you want visitation rights.
I always tell people, look, it's gonna be great, we'll make this film, but you gotta understand something, there's gonna be one guy at the very end, standing there with film cans in his hand, and you're gonna put all your blame on him. Oh, it didn't work because of the director. You can say, well, it's a weak script, but he did a good job, or he didn't do a good job with it, but they're gonna blame him. They always do.
Of course, if I were to become involved, we have to do a little work on the part.
What do you mean? I spent a year on the script, so.
I know, and it's good. But she's not real yet. To start with, what kind of name is Dawn? I'm from the projects in Detroit, and I ain't never met a sister named Dawn.
Well, the script's just a blueprint. It's not written in stone.
If you make this scene absolutely perfect, the paradigm of a motion picture scene, and you do it, make it perfect. And all the scenes are like that. And now it goes to the set. All you need is one of the stars to say, I don't think my character would say that. Right? And no matter, even though everybody thought it was, they're going to change it.
Working with stars has its advantages and it has its disadvantages, but in the end, they're the ones who get the movie made.
Bull Durham has the famous speech. I wrote it just to get a movie star and it worked. It's not my favorite moment in the movie. It's been quoted, it's been published everywhere. I believe in the soul, the cock, the pussy, all that. Lee Harvey Oswald acted alone, and well, it got the right actor. And I thought, well, I'll cut that scene. Everybody loved it, so I kept it, and I was probably wrong, and everybody else was probably right.
There was this experience on Air Force One where I had written this little speech, and Harrison came up to me and he said, it's a great speech. I said, oh, thank you. He said, I'm not going to do it. He said, all this I can do with a look. And he could.
Great line, great speech, great monologue, all gone because it's all, they've said it already over here. And what they're doing is they're giving you a gift. They're showing you where you've overwritten, where you've hit false notes, where you've tried to be clever, but you're full of crap.
Look, Marathon Man had a lot of shit to it, but it got me in a room with Laurence Olivier. And so just to be around talking to him briefly or watching him work is worth gold. You don't get a chance to do that much.
My first job that I got was from Sidney Poitier. He hired me to do a rewrite. Mr. Poitier comes out all 16 feet of him, and because he looked very huge to me. And he says, James, I go, yes, sir. He says, come in. I understand you have a story to tell me. So I said, yes, sir. So I go in, and I was so nervous. My mouth is trying to tell the story, but my mind is screaming, that's Sidney Poitier over there. So I started the rear of the story, went sideways, and went that way, went down. I couldn't tell a linear pitch. I just couldn't get it out. I was jumping around and stuff. Finally, just before I was about to pass out, because I had hyperventilated, I said to Mr. Poitier, I said, I have to stop. And he goes, okay. And he said, what's wrong? I said, well, it's you. He goes, what? I said, well, I'm in the room with you. You've been a hero of mine all my life. And so here I am sitting in the room with you and I can't get my story out. He said, well, take your time. You want some water or something? He said, don't worry, you have the job.
I had been told of a story at MGM about Israel. It was called Cast a Giant Shadow, and the story of Colonel Mickey Marcus. I happened to be interested because he happened to be a relative of mine. He was the last man to fall on the Israeli side before they went into Jerusalem. I went to Burt Lancaster with the story. He says, no, that's not for me. He says, why don't you try Kirk Douglas, because he's not only good, but he's Jewish. We had a great deal of difficulty because Kirk, as you probably know, is not only an important and a great actor, but he's too smart. You can't fool him, and he's usually smarter than I am about a lot of things. And we finally got that picture made in Israel. Tremendous, tremendous difficulties. And long after the picture was out, Kirk finally wrote me a letter. And in the letter, he says, "I think it was a good picture. It could have been better if I paid more attention to you. Love and kisses, Kirk Douglas." So there aren't many of those around, but that's what to see here.
This is during Click. Adam Sandler, I know him from Saturday Night Live, so a very old friend, but he called, he didn't like a line. He was standing on like a second story and there were just 1,000 people in front of him and he had to shout something out. I forget the specific line, but he didn't like it. And he went, "Is Corin here?" So I was like, "Yeah, you know, I left the food," and I ran over. And he's like, he keeps yelling out, you got a better line for this. So, you know, just happens to be 1,000 people staring, you know, while this is happening. And I keep yelling up, you know, some punchline. I don't remember, like, you know, for example, let's say the punchline was, yeah, in your face. So he goes, and he was up high and he goes, "What?" And I go, "Yeah, in your face, what? Yeah, in your face." And he goes, "I don't like that."
Oh God.
And there's just a silence in the crowd. And I'm like, my God. But I kind of been doing it so long, I laughed at the situation. And Adam even looked at me and went, "Sorry, buddy." And then I shouted up another line, he laughed, and of course the whole crowd laughed. And
that's so awesome.
And I was rejected, a very bad rejection.
By 1,000 people.
And of course, then everybody laughed. So
they would have torn you to pieces.
I was on the phone with Morgan Freeman, and we had this long conversation. And afterwards, I said, "You know, listen, I just wanted to tell you that, you know, I wrote this script with you in mind. And the fact that you've made it better than I ever thought it could be, it's just, for me, I really appreciate that, and I'm just thoroughly grateful that you did it." And he said, "You know, look, I didn't really do a whole hell of a lot. You had all the hard work to do, you know? You wrote a great script, and I came in and I pretty much said the words that you wrote."
I had a friend who was one of the most brilliant actresses, Katrin Cartledge. She was notorious for turning down people. She completely went with, like, what character needs me to bring it to life? She actually rejected me for Things Behind the Sun. I wanted her to play the lead female character. She told me, "Allison, this character doesn't need me, but I'm gonna tell you exactly who you need to look for." And I found Kim Dickens, based on the stuff that Katrin had told me. She sadly passed away a couple of years ago, just unexpectedly. She got sick, got sicker, and died. But she was amazing because she didn't care, you know. It was just like whatever character called to her, she was, you know, feature, big money, little money, didn't matter, you know. And so I really take that same attitude.
If you're lucky enough to make a picture with these people, you're going to listen to what they have to say, and you are going to accommodate a lot of what they have to say. Otherwise, they don't want to do the movie.
Take an acting class, or better yet, take a bunch of them, and learn how to act, because there's a vocabulary that's so easily acquired, which tips you, if not to the exact process of an actor's mind, a way to speak to them in their vocabulary that they respect and understand. It's a way of approaching things that lets you know that, hey, I know how hard this job is for you, and I'm not just dicking you around. Let's talk on your terms, and now, because I've had acting training, I'll understand what you're saying, and I'll not only that, I'll demonstrate to you that I appreciate and love actors, because I've tried to be one and I've studied it. It's like going to France and speaking French, you know? Make the effort.
I know the dialogue from the book is slowing the film up, but I can fix that. I learn fast, I always have. Things come... Oh, Christ, George, I can do it. I know what you want. I know what your concept is. I'll make your changes. Let me.
With no resistance?
No. No resistance.
Once you're hired for a job, there's a very high anxiety level, which just stays in the background. It's sort of like a white noise of what's going to happen to me on this little adventure.
They've been through development, they've seen it go this way and that way, and now their mind is just full of questions and fear. Have we done our job? Is this really, should we really trust this writer? You know, and so to somehow pacify them, they can say, well, we'll bring in some other writer just for a fresh look at it.
It's the way executives pretty much cover their asses when it comes to the movie coming out. They say, well, look, we hired, you know, Frank Blow to do this and Joe Schmuck to do that, and that's, we did everything we could to make sure that script was gonna work.
There's a certain pool of money that's set aside for production bonus that gets split between the writers who are credited. And there's no question that your production bonus can be a significant amount of money.
On Zorro, I rewrote probably 85% of the dialogue. And I didn't get screen credit on it. Most people know that I worked on Zorro. And so I think within the industry, that's a fairly well-known fact. But in pure monetary terms, not getting credit on that movie probably cost me $500,000.
You're still required to put all your passion into it in a room by yourself, get on the phone with executives, you know, defend your work. And at the end of the day, you know, you're standing over a trap door and it's not hidden. You know, they say, could you move a little to the left? You're not in the trap door area yet.
If they want somebody else to work on it, there's nothing you can do about it. Learn to love it.
The hardest one was this adaptation of a teen novel. And I pitched it, and it was a tricky one. It's a story about a camp counselor who takes all these kids into the woods and kills them, and all the kids slowly realize that their parents paid the camp counselor to kill them. Awesome story. Still hasn't been made. This was like 8 years ago. But it was a really hard book to crack, and I came up with this great idea, and I presented it to New Line, and they loved it, and they flew me to New York, and they had me pitch it to whatever executive was there. And she actually, in the middle of the meeting, she went, oh my God, that's great. That's brilliant. Perfect. And they gave it to another writer.
The Indiana Jones situation is the perfect emblem of this. You really do chalk it up to creative differences. You know, the movie I had in mind is not the movie that George Lucas had in mind. I have to respect that because George is the producer. And by the way, it's his character. You know, so do I go through life, you know, holding a grudge or clinging to some seething resentment? No, that's ridiculous. If I did that with every project that didn't go well, I'd be Hannibal Lecter. They'd have to lock me up in a cell with a fucking mask on my face.
If I've written a script and then I've been fired and it's been rewritten by 8 other people, if I end up getting screenplay credit on that movie, I'm gonna have to answer for that movie. So I still do have to answer for this movies, you know. I still have to answer for Last Action Hero, you know.
I always feel that when a movie sucks, it's my fault. I mean, I could blame the director or the actors, but I usually feel if a movie is no good, then it's something in the script, something in the storytelling I did that didn't hold. It was just bad. I wrote a line once that caught on out there, nobody knows anything, and they don't. If we knew what we were doing, every movie would be wonderful. If actors knew what they were doing, every performance would be just swell, and it isn't. And directing isn't, and writing isn't. It's just, it's a crapshoot, it just is. There's no answer. I wish there were.
A writer friend of mine once described screenwriters as egomaniacs with low self-esteem. And that's a great description. It was me when I was a screenwriter, certainly. Where on the one hand, you know, you have that hubris that Goethe talked about, you know, where you had to believe that what you wrote was so great, everyone needed to read it, that the world couldn't go on without it. And at the very same moment, the moment a studio executive or director replaces you, you go, God, I knew I was crap.
Even though I have gotten better at picking up the signposts, like, oh boy, the studio executive didn't call me back this week, I think they're out looking for another writer. Oh, I think he didn't like this draft. I think something bad is going to happen. You know, the demons, the zombies are going to break into my psychic room and slash me and rip my throat out. And so I feel, well, I'm a professional. I can see that coming. It doesn't, when they rip your throat out, it doesn't feel any better.
I felt earlier in my career, I was still learning the ropes and still learning my craft as a writer. And I would think, oh, I'm not getting these jobs because I'm not yet seasoned, I'm not a good enough writer to get the jobs. Now I don't feel that. Now I feel like I really know my craft, I know what I'm doing. And now if I do get rejected, I take it far more personally. And think, oh my God, these people are idiots, you know, they just don't know what they're doing, they don't know a good thing when they see it.
If you just define yourself as a screenwriter and you have a bad day as a screenwriter, then that's your whole world. And, you know, you're sort of building your life on this very singular pylon. And it's important to remember, you know, that you're a brother or a sister or a father or a boyfriend, but also that you have interests and hobbies that feed you and nourish you and bring ideas in and balance you out.
You forget that, you know, compared to a normal standard, a normal city or a normal place in the country, like, you're doing very well. So, but it's easy to just get caught up in, like, you know, the LA social. Yeah,
that could actually affect your writing also. Suddenly you want to write a movie about, you know, a guy who's having problems with his investment banker.
Yeah,
and you're like,
exactly.
Yeah, that's relatable. I know. Everybody I know has this problem, and you forget.
Yeah.
You know? I always actually keep my dad in mind when I write. You know, I always think he was a mailman. You know, he came home at night and he loved watching movies. So what could he relate to? You know, and that's what we tend to write. At least I know the ones that we've talked about that excite us are ideas that, you know, everyone can relate to.
Our complaints mean nothing compared to the complaints of people who, you know, are pipe fitters for a job, or you know, working on ships or fighting overseas in the military or things. You know, those guys have things to complain about. And to bitch about somebody making them make a change to their script and having that give them ulcers and sleepless nights, it's just not worth it.
The secret to longevity is to ride this crazy roller coaster and just know that it will happen. It happens to the best of us. It happens to the most famous artists in this field. It happens to the stars. And careers are broken only if the artist allows it to be broken.
I don't have a track record of my own, unfortunately. I'm still very much weighted by the lack of having no produced credits, and that's been my biggest ball and chain to drag around. Even though I was given almost immediate access to a industry and a life that most people fight for years to get into, there was definitely an earning process of some sort that came afterwards.
One of the things that Mr. Charles and I had in common is that I used to use heroin like he used heroin and stuff, but we both were creative at the time. Of course, he did a lot more with his creativity than I did, you know, but I imagined being here. That's what kept me going. And that was one of the reasons, one of the ways in which I was able to kick drugs was that I knew this is what I wanted to do. I did imagine this. I imagined getting to this, but I'm glad I got here sober.
I remember Alvin Sargent saying to me when he saw Running on Empty, "This makes me want to do my own best work." And I never got a compliment better than that. And whenever I see something that makes me feel that way, I try to say it to the person whose work I've just seen.
It's okay. You'll survive. It may be a great idea that you've done. It may be your best work, but you'll do another one. It's not, this is my masterpiece, and they screwed it up. Well, but they paid you for it, okay? They paid you for your masterpiece. So stop bitching, stop whining, and move on.
I was fairly depressed at one point that I was getting these action movies made and was not getting paid a lot of money. And so I went to therapy. I said, okay, some guy was offering a little therapy thing on for writers, for creative people. So I said, okay, I'll go talk it out. I'm feeling bad. I'll go and sit and talk it out with some other people in the same situation. So I go and I'm there going to therapy because I'm getting these movies made and not making a lot of money. In this session is this other guy who's working over at Warner Brothers, getting paid an awful lot of money, but he can't get any movies made. So that's why he's in therapy.
So I'm going, all right. Maybe it's not so bad. I'll just get over my issue because the other side of the fence is not all that pretty either.
To begin. How to start? I'm hungry. I should get coffee. Coffee would help me think. But I should write something first, then reward myself with coffee. Coffee and a muffin. Okay, so I need to establish the themes. Maybe banana nut. That's a good muffin.
Only once in my career have I written a script and someone just gave me the check for a rewrite and said, we don't want you to do the rewrite, we think it's perfect. And then a year later, they decided it wasn't, so.
I don't think a lot of people perceive it as the kind of real job that it is, in the sense that it's real time that you actually have to spend doing it. It doesn't just go from here to here automatically. Like, you actually have to do this, and you have to do this, and you have to do this, and you have to do this. And you have to, you know, like, it's hours and hours of work that everyone's like, oh, you have a cushy life.
It's really not as glamorous as you might imagine. You know, it's frustrating. I miss the action of being on set. And you know, when we did X-Men, I was extremely lucky because I was on set for every minute. And, you know, you've got the sets and the cameras and the actors, or they'll bring in a tank, or they'll do, you know, all the fun stuff of the movies. Well, you don't get a lot of that as a screenwriter.
You can't just say, well, I'm not really inspired by an idea yet, so I'm just going to hang out and see what hits me, and maybe I'll write a scene and see where it takes me. I don't know any writers who are successful who approach writing that way at all. You have to look at it like it is a full-time job.
There is a natural physical resistance in the universe towards finishing it, whatever it happens to be. It's always a mountain slightly higher than you could have imagined it. And it takes a little more strength than you thought you possibly had.
You should watch African Queen. And there's a scene when Humphrey Bogart gets out of the river covered with leeches. And then he hates that more than anything in the world, leeches. And they take all the leeches off. And then, you know, the boat's stuck in the reeds. And then the scene where he has to climb back in the water and pull the boat again, you know, with all the leeches, that's how I feel when I have to do another draft.
I wrote 14 drafts of Aquila and the Bee before we shot it. The third draft won the Nickel Fellowship. I'm glad I didn't shoot that draft, because that draft was not ready.
Chinatown took 17 drafts, and none of us are as good as Robert Towne. Amadeus, I think, took 46, and none of us are as good as Peter Shaffer. So all that means is that the previous 45 of Amadeus, someone said, Peter, you can do better. And I'm sure it pissed him off and hurt his feelings, but he kept writing, and he wound up with one of the best movies ever.
I wrote 41 drafts of my story before Todd Black felt like he could give it to Fox. And then after that, you know, the executives gave me a lot of notes, and then I went on writing more. Me and Denzel and Todd worked on it for 9 years, almost, well, 6 years. And so I must have written over 100 drafts of that story.
The thing to come to this business with is sort of a respect for it. And when you respect something, you try and figure it out in a different way, as opposed to, I didn't like that movie. That movie stunk. I could write a movie. That's probably why that movie stunk, because whoever wrote that movie had the same attitude.
The blank page that I know a lot of writers are terrified by, to me, is very welcoming. It's something I can fill it with. It's my task, my mandate, my joy, even the days you pace, to put words and characters on that page to help me sort out my life.
Even though I could get a lot of jobs by myself and keep all the money, I realized ultimately the script would only be half as good. So I carefully selected writers who excelled at character. My main weakness is a writer. So by plugging that hole, I'd rather have my name co-writer of a brilliant script than sole writer of a good script.
Sometimes it's just like, you wrote one really good sentence, and you may never get sort of
called out for it. You may never sort of get the props for it that you deserve, but you know that you wrote a really good sentence. And unlike a lot of the jobs in this business, at least you have the pages you wrote. And a director doesn't have anything unless somebody gives them permission to make a movie. A writer can at least always write a script, and that's sort of the one great luxury we have is, you know, words are cheap.
Kiss Kiss Bang Bang started as a romantic comedy, then it was a straight comedy, then it was, I added the detective character and it became this very darker, it was a thriller, then I went back in time to the 40s and tried to, you know, get some of these old-time detective pulp novels involved and sort of say everything I had to say about that. By the end, it's sort of this mishmash, it's a pulp style homage slash fairy tale retro film noir comedy, kids in a big city, Capra-esque murder tragedy. You know, it's just, it's everything stuffed together. And for some reason that one worked, but you know, you can play that game forever and never get anything done.
I don't think there's any such thing as a perfect script, and you know, when people say that The Sting is a perfect script, you know, it's nice to have people say that, but it's slightly embarrassing to me, because I just don't think there is, I don't think there's a perfect anything.
I don't know what it means, a perfect script. I think you just want to basically try and figure out the fucking story and stay on the story as long as you can and as closely as you can and end it. I think when you start telling yourself, I want to write a great thing, I want to write a, you know, you're gonna, all you're gonna do is castrate yourself and get in deeper and deeper trouble. It's hard to do anyway. It's no fun going into your pit every day and trying to figure out how to get two or three or five pages, because some days you don't do anything. And then you think, well, why? And then you start, then what if you have two crappy days in a row, then you're really in deep shit. You know, it's just, you don't want to, you just want to get it done, and you pray someone will like it.
The Sting has been cited. Butch Cassidy and the Sundance Kid has been cited. God, I would make an argument for Casablanca and It's a Wonderful Life and Double Indemnity. You know, these are the best of what we get. These are the best of what we do. Perfection, I think it probably should remain the mirage that you keep chasing. Because if you ever achieve it, then you might as well just give up. You might as well throw in the towel and say, okay, I'm done. pack me up, take me out of here. Put me on the stretcher and take me, you know, take me to the old folks home. You know, I think you gotta keep trying for that.
I won't work on something I don't like.
Nix, my boy, how many times must I tell you?
I know, it's just another picture.
But are you in any position to be choosy? You haven't written a hit since before the war, and your last picture...
So it stunk. Everybody makes flops except you. You haven't had one because you've made and remade the same picture for the last 20 years. You know what you are? You're a popcorn salesman.
That's right, so are you. The only difference between us is that I don't fight it.
One day I'll surprise you and write something good.
I have a small movie that I've written, and if it's my last one, that's fine, and I'm in business with a man, then we're going to, you know, hopefully raise the money and do the film. And I'm looking forward to that. But I'm also picking up my novel career again and writing short stories and so on. So it's hard for me, you know, to love what I do and then make peace with a film that makes you wince and cringe every, you know, maybe every 20 minutes or maybe just twice during the movie if you're lucky.
There's a certain point at which you want to do what you want to do. You don't want to do what the market is telling you you got to do in order to make it. And it was my feeling that it was really time for me to go. Right now I'm in New York. I'm doing producing. I've done a bit of producing on Broadway, a bit off Broadway. And it's fun. It's satisfying in some way, although producing is one thing and writing is another.
I was having lunch with a producer at La Dome who wanted me to write a movie, and I had just finished a pilot at ABC, and I was late for going down to a psychiatric hospital where I worked doing group therapy with schizophrenics. And I couldn't wait for the lunch to be over so I could get in the car and get down there. And driving down there, I said, what's wrong with this picture? And I knew then that I was going to sit for the exam and become a therapist.
Something New, formerly called 42.4%, was just like such a passion piece. I'm telling you, I was so fired up. I couldn't stop thinking about, you know, the feature. I had to write it. And, you know, I wasn't thinking about money or get this. I had to write this thing. The next spec that I write. I don't know how I'm gonna, like, I'm waiting for that spark, and that spark may not come, you know? So it may be something that I just really have to sit and start writing and then discover the magic in it.
I remember I saw some quote about being a professional gambler, and it was, it's a hard way to make an easy living. And I think screenwriting is kind of be the same thing, you know? It's a lot of fun, and it's the hardest thing I'll ever do.
I cannot recommend the road I have taken. It's just too much damn work. I've wondered from time to time why I keep at it. I keep at it just because I can't bear the alternative. Occasionally, people do ask me about whether they should get involved in screenwriting or filmmaking. And I usually say, you know, if you can find any happiness or satisfaction in another field of endeavor, you should do so. Because the real reason to get involved in the arts is because you have no choice.
I love the experience of writing. I love the way it takes off, and sometimes the characters start talking for themselves and the situations start changing, and suddenly you're just kind of like the court stenographer writing down what these people are saying, and the movie turns out entirely differently than you expected it to. I often say, you know, after I write the script, you can come in the room and search the room and you won't find anybody else in there. I did it all by myself.
I think back on some images that were really just crazy crap in my own head that's now up there in some films that I've written. That's pretty amazing. I mean, it really is like having some projector from your brain.
I get to actually live out my dream that I had ever since I was a kid to be a part of Hollywood and to actually see movies get made and to actually see an audience react to an idea that I had once. And I sat down and I wrote it, and remember when we were up at 3:30 in the morning trying to get that shot, and now here we are eating cheese and crackers at the screening, and they're laughing at the jokes. There's no better feeling.
The old cliche is true. You write one movie, you direct another movie, and you edit a third movie. And in that regard, you have to trust and embrace the process that in the beginning was the word, but it's going to end up pictures.
The thing that's so awful about being a screenwriter is you do the best you can, and you have no idea if the story you've chosen is going to hold for an audience.
The slow build of Shawshank was really quite remarkable for me because it was so not immediately embraced by the audience. You sit there and you go, well, what does it take? You know, you make the best movie you can. You know it's working. What does it take to get people to see it? Well, in our case, what it took were the 7 Academy Award nominations we got that year. You know, people really, really dig it. More than that, it means a lot to some people. There are some people for whom it's sort of more than a movie. And I take great satisfaction in that because I have a few movies that, for me, were more than a movie when I was growing up. And maybe I'll never make another thing that people do love on that level. And that's fine by me because at least I've had one.
You always go back to the source and the kid you were when you were hungry, while you were still eating, breathing, and sleeping this stuff. Then it reminds you not just of where you've been, but where you've yet to go. And hopefully reinstills in you a little bit of that childish hunger. When you lose that, you lost everything.
I had an office job once for a year and a half, and I was suicidal. I was 22. I was maybe suicidal anyway, but I mean, I really, you know, I love that I actually get paid more or less to do what I do. And whenever I'm feeling whiny and sorry for myself, I'm like, you're not homeless. You're not dying of cancer. You slept till 10. You get to go out and party tonight. Your life rules.
This is a last laugh business. And if you can survive, as people are kicking you in the head, eventually their leg will get tired. They will want to start kicking someone else. If you're still there and can pull yourself up to your feet, you get the last laugh.
What's fascinating is how much of Hollywood is filled with people who did not grow up here, didn't know anything about it, like me when I was a kid. They just love movies and they love storytelling, and they really wanted to try to find a way to make something happen.
I may not have a big name or big, you know, $300 million movies under my belt, but I've got work that I can be proud of and work that I've often generated myself.
It's a great way to make a living in the sense that they pay you a bunch of money, and the smart writer can kind of ignore everything until 2 weeks before you have to deliver it. If you've written a good outline, then just bang it out and turn it in, and they pay you more money. I mean, it's not a bad way to go.
My life did not have a huge following. I don't know the actual numbers of people that saw the film, but the power of the connection between those who did and me was enormous. The studio sends you a packet of all the reviews from your movies across the country, and I started reading those reviews, and they were one after another a below the belt punch, and I just went, oh, I was on the floor. I was on the floor for months after that movie came out. I thought it was the biggest failure I had ever been involved in. The movie just had not performed at the level the studio wanted, at the level I wanted. The reviews were terrible. And then about 9 months later, a woman comes up to me at a party and she says, my husband died of cancer a year ago, and our son and I never talked about it. My son couldn't speak about it. He was 12. He's now 13. I now have cancer, and I have 6 months to live, she told me. And I'm just kind of reeling as she's saying this. She said, about a week or two after your movie came out, my son and I went to see it. When the movie was over, we went back home, and he was sobbing. And he crawled into my lap, and he and I had the dialogue that I needed to have to leave this world. And it would not have happened without your movie, so thank you. And something just happened to me, of course, pretty obviously, I guess, at that moment. I realized I made the movie for her, and it was enough.
I stay positive through wealth. Because I'm rich, I'm positive. No, I'm kidding.
A producer is someone that lies well enough and long enough until the lie becomes the truth.
I did this one pitch with this director that I ended up working with until I almost killed him.
My partner and I talk about this. We always wanted to put out a mock issue of Variety that's called Anxiety. And the front page is, you don't get the three-picture deal. That guy you hate is nominated for an Academy Award. Everybody but you just got a production bonus.
You're the man at the moment for only a moment, and that moment does pass.
The rules don't actually change. You just start getting lied to by a higher caliber of person.
Sometimes it's a relief. There's the old joke, who do I have to fuck to get off this picture?
I've been able to work at the top level of television and be protected by Steven Spielberg or Stephen King. I mean, there's always an 800-pound gorilla on either side, and I'm the 50-pound chimp in the middle being pulled both ways.
Nobody sets out to fuck up your movie. It's not like the director or the stars wake up in the morning and say, let me screw up this scene. How can I really cause Bill Goldman pain? It's just they're terrified. Everybody in the movie, no one knows what they're doing.
Write a great script. I mean, that's the simplest thing in the world to say. It's the hardest thing in the world to do. There is no advice that can protect you from what's going to happen.
Perfect.
All right, done.